Bueno, buenos días para todos y para todas. Les pido el favor de poner en silencio sus teléfonos celulares en este momento para que demos inicio al evento. Mi nombre es Esteban Hoyos Ceballos, soy profesor del área de Derecho Público y coordinador de la maestría en Derecho de la Universidad de AFID. Quiero dar un saludo especial esta mañana al juez Albi Sachs, a su esposa Vanessa, que nos acompaña acá en el auditorio, a los profesores Natalia Ángel, José Toro, que nos acompañarán también en la mesa principal más tarde, a nuestra jefe de departamento, la profesora Ana Silvia Gallo, la coordinadora de posgrados de la Escuela de Derecho, la doctora María Virginia Gaviria, a los egresados de la maestría en Derecho, estudiantes, mis colegas, profesores, y a todos ustedes esta mañana a esta conferencia conmemorativa de los 5 años de la maestría en Derecho. Antes de comenzar, quiero dar también un agradecimiento muy especial a la Universidad de los Andes y a su decana, a la decana de la Facultad de Derecho, Catalina Botero, que nos apoyó con la financiación del viaje del magistrado Sachs a Colombia, a la profesora Alma Beltrán de la Universidad del Rosario, cuyo contacto fue esencial para la visita de Albi Sachs a Medellín, a la oficina del magistrado Alejandro Linares, presidente de la Corte Constitucional, que coordinó la agenda de Albi Sachs en Colombia, una agenda que concluye hoy en la ciudad de Medellín, después de un viaje por toda Colombia, por Santa Marta, Bogotá y ahora Medellín. Y también a nuestro decano, el profesor Camilo Piedraíta, quien esta mañana no puede acompañarnos, pero cuyo apoyo fue decisivo para que este evento tuviera lugar. Seré breve en esta introducción, pero quiero resaltar dos cosas. Pues la primera, la alegría de celebrar con ustedes los 5 años del programa de maestría en Derecho de esta universidad. Esta maestría es un proyecto colectivo, un trabajo en permanente construcción y mejoramiento que surgió por la iniciativa de los profesores y directivos de la escuela y la universidad, que reconocimos una necesidad en la ciudad de formación de profesionales a nivel de maestría que pueden o puedan contribuir a la resolución de problemas concretos en los sectores social, gubernamental, empresarial, académico, y que además puedan hacer contribuciones específicas a debates teóricos y prácticos que permiten el desarrollo del conocimiento jurídico en los planos local, nacional e internacional. De igual forma, en todas sus líneas, derecho público, derecho de familia, responsabilidad civil, esta maestría ha pretendido desde su fundación aportar de alguna manera, de alguna forma, a la consolidación del Estado Social de Derecho en Colombia. Sin embargo, y esto sería mi segundo punto, nuestras preocupaciones no son solo nacionales. El programa y sus profesores tenemos preocupaciones que trascienden las fronteras nacionales. Por eso cada año tenemos en la maestría profesores internacionales que nos visitan en los cursos, conferencias y eventos académicos que organizamos. Nos parece clave promover y participar de discusiones jurídicas globales con otros países, particularmente aquellos que pertenecen al denominado sur global, países que por sus condiciones, sus problemas, su historia, enfrentan y han enfrentado desafíos similares a los nuestros. Y hoy creo que tenemos un invitado de lujo para profundizar en esa apuesta global que hemos hecho y seguiremos haciendo en el programa. Albi Sachs, activista de derechos humanos y ex magistrado de la Corte Constitucional Sudafricana. Albi estudió Derecho en la Universidad de la Ciudad del Cabo, tiene un doctorado de la Universidad de Sussex en Inglaterra y este número puede estar desactualizado, 14 doctorados honoris causa concedidos por universidades en 4 continentes. 23 me dice, 23 me dice Vanessa, o sea, está desactualizado, ya lo sabía. Como saben, Albi fue magistrado de la Corte Constitucional Sudafricana al ser designado por Nelson Mandela tras las primeras elecciones democráticas celebradas en 1994, ocupando este cargo hasta el año 2009. Albi Sachs es entonces una figura internacional reconocida por su rol crucial en la consolidación de una Sudáfrica democrática, tanto en su rol como activista de derechos humanos, como en su rol como juez constitucional. Destaco en la obra de Albi sus libros La venganza suave, un luchador por la libertad, Justicia en Sudáfrica, El diario de la cárcel de Albi Sachs, Sexismo y derecho, y La extraña alquimia de la vida y el derecho. Estamos muy felices de tener hoy a Albi Sachs nuevamente en Colombia, en Medellín y en EAFIT. Finalmente, nos acompañarán con sus comentarios dos profesores de nuestra maestría que conocen el trabajo de Sachs y nos ayudarán a situarlo y a dialogar con él en nuestro propio contexto. Mi amiga, la profesora Natalia Ángel Cabo, abogada de la Universidad de los Andes, magíster en Derecho de la Universidad de Harvard, con estudios de doctorado en la Universidad de Osgoode Hall, en Canadá. Natalia es una autoridad nacional e internacional en materia de derechos de las personas con discapacidad y sobre todo en materia de derechos económicos y sociales, particularmente en la implementación de sentencias constitucionales en los territorios. Natalia es profesora de planta de la Universidad de los Andes de Derecho Constitucional y de nuestro curso en la maestría sobre políticas públicas y derechos. Gracias, Natalia, por acompañarnos. El profesor José Toro, que también nos acompañará esta mañana, es abogado de la Universidad Pontificia Bolivariana, magíster en Derecho de American University en Washington, D.C., también magíster y doctor en Derecho de la Universidad Pompeu Fabra en Barcelona. José es profe del área de Derecho Internacional, también de nuestra maestría en varios de sus cursos, y sus intereses investigativos se centran sobre todo en la teoría del derecho internacional, órdenes jurídicos transnacionales, arbitraje internacional, sociología de la profesión legal y el rol de los actores no estatales en las relaciones internacionales. A Natalia y a José les doy las gracias por unirse a esta celebración y también por ser parte de esta apuesta, de este proyecto académico de nuestra maestría. Al finalizar, primero tendremos la conferencia de Albi y al finalizar su intervención daremos la palabra para los comentarios de Natalia y de José y luego una ronda de preguntas con ustedes que me encargaré de moderar. Concluyo esta presentación entonces invitando a Albi Sachs a que inicie con su conferencia El juez que lloró, protegiendo los derechos económicos y sociales en Sudáfrica. Démosle por favor la bienvenida a Albi con un aplauso.
This is my last day on what's been a wonderful, wonderful visit to Colombia at an interesting and difficult time in the life of the nation. It's been very intense and very emotional for me to be here. Extraordinary meeting in the plenary session of the Constitutional Court, visiting 3 universities, now a 4th. So my heart is very full, and it's the last day. And I'm going to leave Colombia, unless I change my program a little bit, without having sung. And I'm going to give you a double bill today. It will be the Albi who cried, and the Albi who sang. El juiz que lloró y el juiz que cantó. And I'm going to take advantage of the fact that this is the centenary of the birth of Nelson Mandela, which is being celebrated in South Africa. His life is being applauded. His life is being criticized. An enormous international figure, and it's appropriate that he sits here in one of these seats in your imagination on this day. And I start with the 6th of April, 1952. I love coming to South African audiences and saying, where were you on the 6th of April, 1952? And it was only at one literary book fair in a seaside resort for retired people that a lot of people could put up their hands. And I asked South Africans what was special about that day, and very, very few know, which in a sense is a victory for us, because the 6th of April, 1652, was the day when a Dutch commander arrived in Cape Town, planted the Dutch East India Company flag, and the way we were taught at school, South African history began. South African history being the history of white conquest and the advance of what they called white civilization. And 1952, the tercentenary, 300 years afterwards, the racist government of South Africa that had come to power in elections, white people only voting, on a policy which they invented called apartheid, introducing the word apartheid into the international lexicon. They've been in power now since 1948, for 4 years, and they were triumphant, they were jubilant, they were celebrating. The aeroplanes were flying overhead, the armored cars were going through the streets of town, and about 200 of us were in a small hall, smaller, not as beautiful as this hall, in a working class district in Cape Town. Maybe 190 black and 10 white. And we were singing. And in those days, the songs of the African National Congress, the ANC, which I'll be speaking about quite a lot today, were very sad. My boy, my boye, Africa, my boye, Africa, come back, Africa. Senzenina, Senzenina, what have we done to deserve this? Senzenina, Senzenina, Senzenina. Senzenina. And even to this day, that song is sang in South Africa. And suddenly, Dr. Maraka, Dr. Dadu, J.B. Marks, Katani Liver Puppy, volunteers, obey the orders, be ready for the action now. Volunteers, obey the orders, volunteers, obey the orders, volunteers, obey the orders, be ready for the action now. And they're calling for volunteers. It's the beginning of the Defiance of Unjust Laws campaign. The oppressed people of South Africa are now, in a non-violent way, going to challenge the racist laws that were keeping them oppressed. Six laws are chosen. The one, the pass laws. Every black African man had to carry with him, day and night, a document called the pass, and presented to any policeman anywhere, could come into your home, you're sleeping at night, you're walking in the streets, where's your pass? Show your pass. The pass controlled your life to be where you were. If you worked, you needed the pass to be signed. If you moved from one part to the other, the pass had to permit you to do that. The people were going to go out into the streets without their passes. There was a curfew hour at night a siren would go at 9 o'clock, 9:30 in most cities. No black person could be out on the streets without a certificate from the madam or the master. People were going to go out on the streets after that hour without the permission. Benches, public benches, whites only, whites only, whites only, non-whites only. Overwhelmingly reserved for whites in all public facilities. Black people were going to sit on benches, riding buses, go on trains reserved for whites only. Six laws were chosen. One was called the Suppression of Communism Act. And communism was so widely defined to include any protest action that could be unlawful in the country. People were going to defy that act, six laws. And they're calling for volunteers. And the singing is getting louder and louder and stronger and stronger. And I say to my friend, my comrade, who had been in World War II against Hitler, he'd come back, he'd fought racism in Europe, he's now fighting racism in his own country. And I say, Wolfie, I want to join. He says, you can't. I say, why? Because you're white. We're fighting racism. This is a black struggle led by black people. But I'll report it to the leadership. And 6 months later, I'm leading a group of three students, one worker, young white people, into the General Post Office to sit on seats marked non-whites only. Now, why do I mention this to you in connection with centenary of Nelson Mandela? I was volunteer number 8,549 or something. Volunteer number one was Nelson Mandela. He was the first person, newly qualified lawyer, couldn't vote, had to carry his pass, didn't have basic rights, but he could make some money, have some income, have some social prestige as a lawyer. And he was now going to jeopardize his career, voluntarily go to jail as part of the struggle of his people. And I ask the question sometimes in South Africa, what was the one good thing that apartheid produced? And people are a little bit worried. I'm going to be an apologist. And I say the one good thing apartheid produced was anti-apartheid. If it hadn't been for apartheid, I would never have met Nelson Mandela. He grew up in a rural area, in a traditional society. I grew up in Cape Town. My grandparents had come as refugees from Lithuania, where Jews were being persecuted. Every Easter time, the Cossacks would ride up into their little villages and say, the Jews killed Christ, we're going to kill the Jews. And they would hide in forests, they would hide in basements, and they left to go to many parts of the world. I think some would have come to Colombia as well. And my parents became politically active, socialists, anti-racists, organizing workers, and I grew up in that kind of setting. Cosmopolitan. We meet because we have a common hatred of the system of injustice. The commonality extends in different ways after that. He's locked up, I'm locked up. And it's very curious because everything in South Africa is done according to the law. It's injustice according to the law. Laws passed in Parliament with proper majorities, published in the Government Gazette, that people can be thrown into prison without a charge, without a trial, without a judicial order, without contact with their families, with anybody, into solitary confinement, according to the law, for 90 days. And I'm in prison. Now, I've been introduced as a human rights activist. I wasn't a human rights activist. I was a freedom fighter. It was different. We weren't just fighting for more rights in our country. We were fighting for a country. We were fighting against a whole system. We couldn't get any meaningful rights if the system was fundamentally wrong. You can't have civil rights for a slave. You can't have civil rights for a colonized people. You can't have civil rights for people dominated by apartheid. So we had to resist the system of apartheid as a system. And I might say it reached the stage where many of us were even irritated by the term human rights. A little bit later, Henry Kissinger of the United States is promoting we, the land of the free, defending human rights for all humanity. And meanwhile, they're training assassins to kill Pinochet, to assassinate others, to bring down revolutionary governments that have been fighting against local dictatorships. So we spoke about so-called human rights. It was one word, so-called human rights. And then, this is years later in my story, I'm attending an international conference in London. One of the few virtues of exile is you meet other exiles from all over the world. And the debates are very intense and very strong. And now it's in the 70s, and there are many people from Latin America, Chileans, Argentines, Brazilians, Colombians, and they're speaking about derechos humanos with the same passion, the same commitment that we are speaking about national liberation. And I realized we shouldn't say so-called human rights. We want human rights. But we must give human rights a meaning that's important not just for the rights of property owners and newspaper owners, but the rights for ordinary people. And we must reclaim human rights from the Kissingers of the world and make it really people's rights for human beings in our country. In any event, I'm now thrown into prison. And we used to read literature from all over the world. Prison literature. I don't know if there's anybody in this room, you're not quite that generation. Your parents' generation, if they were combatants, would have been reading Nazım Hikmet from Turkey, imprisoned for decades in Turkey, wrote beautiful, beautiful poetry. Henri Allègue, who'd been imprisoned by the French in Algeria, he was a Frenchman. Wonderful book about his interrogation with a marvelous preface by Jean-Paul Sartre on torture and the use of torture. And other literature like that. Julius Fučík, Notes from the Gallows. He'd been imprisoned by the Nazis, Gestapo. And we read it to prepare ourselves. It doesn't help. It doesn't help. It doesn't help. You're in another universe. Another universe. And it was worse than I had imagined. Just solitary confinement. Just solitary confinement. Isolation. That sense of total dependence on others. No human beings you can speak to. Human beings are, I think it's now in our DNA. We are prepared, even genetically, to associate with other human beings. To sing, to laugh, to cry, to speak, to be angry with, to shout out, to whisper to. And suddenly, you're alone. You stare at your toes, you stare at the wall, your toes. And then I would sing. And I'd move around myself, da-da-da-da, using Beethoven to give me some sense of pride. And then I'd go through the alphabet, always, because Charmaine, Daisy, with X I had to cheat. So I would say deep in the heart of Texas, you have words that begin with X, Xavier, So maybe if you were Colombian in prison, you could start a song with X. And my favorite was Always. I don't know if you know that song. It's by Irving Berlin. He wrote it for his wife. And it was used afterwards by a British playwright called Noel Coward, who wrote plays of upper middle class manners for the West End in London. I'll be loving you always with a love that's true, always. So now I'm changing it. I'll be living here always, year after year, always. In this little cell that I know so well, I'll be living swell, always, always. And I'd waltz around and feel very amused that the song used in a play of upper middle class manners in London is being used to keep up the spirit of a freedom fighter in Cape Town. I'll be living in, always, keeping up my chin, always, not for but a week, not for but a month, not for 90 days, but always, and I'd twirl around again. After 90 days, and I'm scratching on the wall like prisoners do, I'm going to be released. I'm very suspicious. They give me back my watch. They give me back my shoes with shoelaces. They give me back my tie. I've been going into my office as an advocate. They give me back my winter suit because I was locked up at the end of winter. It's now the middle of summer. I go downstairs. Am I free? Yes, you're free. And before I can reach the street, one of my interrogators comes up to me. And in terms of South African law, when you arrest somebody, you touch them. Instead of touching me, he puts out his hand and says, I'm placing you under arrest under the 90-day law. They complied with the law. The law says you can arrest for 90 days. You release the person for 1 minute and for another 90 days. And this case had been taken on appeal to our top court, and our top court said that's okay. The judges didn't have to do it. They voluntarily went along with the interpretation that would aid the police as much as possible rather than support the rights, the traditional cultural legal rights of our people. Back again, they take my watch, they take my shoes, the shoelaces, they take my tie, and it's another 78 days and I'm released as suddenly as I was arrested, no charge. I never found out why. I was so excited. I ran from that prison in the center of Cape Town more than I'd run in my life, through all the suburbs, those of you who know Cape Town, through Greenpoint, down Sea Point, up to Clifton, down the steps, and I threw myself into the waves. And before that, I see my colleagues, advocates, that come in their suits down to the beach. And they think I'm going a little bit crazy, into the waves. And I felt joyous and triumphant. I hadn't answered any questions, but something inside me was broken. You never, never, never get over solitary confinement. Some years pass. I'm now in exile in London for 11 years. I did my PhD at Sussex University. I had books published. I go to Mozambique, newly independent Mozambique. I learn the Portuguese language. I learn to say viva! Viva o povo unido ao Maputo! Long live the people united from Rovuma to Maputo. Viva emancipação da mulher! Long live emancipation of women. It was a fantastic time. But I also learned that revolutionary projects, marvelous, brilliant, humane revolutionary projects, don't automatically sustain themselves. We were isolated, we were undermined. There was no space for opposition. If there's no space for opposition, opposition goes underground. It gets picked up in the Cold War. It becomes armed opposition. You have millions of refugees. You have a country filled with people without limbs, mainly from landmines. And in a very strange way, I become a convert to pluralism in revolutionary Mozambique. Not because it was cruel, not because it was ugly, but because it couldn't sustain itself. And I became converted to the idea that we need the rule of law, not for the rich. The poor need the rule of law. The rich have got money, they've got power, they don't need rule of law. The poor, if somebody is locked up, the poor can't get by knowing an important official who will speak to the station commander. They need rights. So paradoxically, I learned the importance of fundamental human rights in revolutionary Mozambique, where I'm supporting the revolutionary project. And I learned the importance of political pluralism in Mozambique, where I went to support a state that was led by Frelimo, organizing the workers, the peasants in that society. And one day, it's the day of the Mozambican woman. It's now the 7th of April, Dia de Mulher Mozambicana. It's a public holiday, and I'm going to the beach, and I don't know what's happening. I'm in total darkness. And I just know it's something ugly. When I used to climb the mountain, I was a very keen mountain climber. And I would bang my head on a rock and get that concussion. It was like that. But then the concussion would go away, it didn't go away. And into the darkness, in the darkness, I hear a voice. Albi e Ivo Garrido Kafala, tu estás no Hospital Central de Mozambique. Teu braço está numa condição lamentável. Tens de enfrentar o futuro com coragem. I respond, o que aconteceu? Into the darkness. And a woman's voice answers, foi carro bomba. And I faint. But into joy, I thought I was being kidnapped to be thrown into prison in South Africa, and I know I'm in the hands of Frelimo, I'm safe. And I had a total conviction that as I got better, my country would get better. That was 1988, 2 years before Mandela was released. And I'm lying in the darkness, I'm waking up, I can't see anything. I'm feeling very light, very happy. People tell me afterwards that sometimes the effect of the injections after a 7-hour operation. And I tell myself a joke. It's a joke about Jaime Cohen, like me as a Jew. He falls off a bus and he does this. And someone says, Jaime, I didn't know you were Catholic. What do you mean Catholic? Spectacles, testicles, wallet and watch. And for some reason, I started with testicles. I spent my whole life trying without success to be macho. But now the word went round the ANC camps. And the first thing Comrade Albi did was reach for his balls. Seemed to be in order. Wallet, my heart is okay. Spectacles, if my brain is damaged, that's serious. There's a crater there, but it doesn't seem to be too bad. And watch, I've lost an arm. I've only lost an arm. That moment every freedom fighter is waiting for. Will they come for me? Will they come for me today? If they come for me, will I be brave? They've come for me, they tried to kill me, and I had survived. I felt triumphant. And that was 1988, and I still feel triumphant. It hasn't left me. Somehow, that experience blew away the heaviness, the sediment of misery from my solitary confinement. In any event, some weeks later, I'm in hospital recovering in London, and I'm feeling happy and joyous. And I'm learning to do everything again. I'm learning to write with my left. I'm learning to stand up. I want to say, look, mommy, I can write, with that same excitement that I hadn't thought of since I was a little child. It's like having a whole new life beginning again. But I'd wake up in the morning, maybe 4 a.m., hospital is dark, the painkillers are wearing off. I'd feel sad for myself, just that quiet moment with myself, and I would sing. Now, I'm very secular. I grew up in a home, my parents made these decisions about religion. That was the world I grew up in. But the song I'm singing is what we used to call a Negro spiritual. It's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's not my brother nor my sister, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's not my brother nor my sister, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Now, when I do this in South Africa, the audience joins in. it's me, O Lord, standing in the need. And I'd go through, it's not my uncle nor my auntie, it's not my cousin, and so on. Feeling a little bit sorry for myself. Fall asleep, wake up a bit later, the nurse comes with a cup of tea, and I'm cheerful again. I receive a letter. Most of you won't even know these letters with stamps on. We used to lick the envelope, and I open it with my left, and it has a note that says, "Don't worry, Comrade Albie, we will avenge you." And I think, avenge me? We're going to cut off the arms? We're going to blind in one eye? Is that the country we want? Is that what we are fighting for? But if we get democracy, if we get freedom, that will be my soft vengeance. That thought came into my head. Roses and lilies will grow out of my arm. And a few weeks later, I'm still in the hospital bed, and I get a message. Have you heard? Have you heard? They've caught one of the persons who put the bomb in Comrade Albie's car. And I say to myself, if he is put on trial, and if the evidence cannot prove beyond reasonable doubt that he is guilty, and he is acquitted, that will be my soft vengeance, because then we're living under the rule of law. And that's much more important than that one rascal goes to jail. So that theme of soft vengeance became the theme of my life. And going back to South Africa, helping to write the Constitution that brought freedom to our nation, that gave us a nation, that ended up giving us possibly the most advanced constitution in the world, that includes in its foundational value of non-racism and non-sexism in the Constitution. That includes in the Constitution strong elements of participatory democracy. That includes in the Constitution a very expansive comprehensive equality clause. That includes race, color, creed, national origin, parentage, disability, sexual orientation. 1996 again, an overwhelmingly black, overwhelmingly working class parliament includes a prohibition of unfair discrimination on grounds of sexual orientation in our constitution. Very strong gender rights running right through the constitution, with the women's movement saying, we don't want a section called rights for women. Aren't women voters? Aren't women people claiming all the other rights? We want a gender vision in relation to every aspect of the Constitution. And it comes through most powerfully in our Section 12 that deals with freedom. And freedom is not only the right not to be subjected to arbitrary detention, not only expressly the right not to have detention without trial. My generation, in fact, I insisted at the constitution-making process, detention without trial must be put in expressly. It became the foundation of all the torture, the violations, the total undermining of our criminal procedure was based on detention without trial. But it also includes the right to bodily integrity. section on the right to freedom, which includes the right to make decisions about reproduction expressed in our Constitution. It includes the right to be free from violence from public or private sources. Domestic violence is seen not simply as a criminal law matter, it's a constitutional law matter that's in our Constitution. This is all part of what I call my soft vengeance. And then I'm put on to the Constitutional Court. Wow. I'd never imagined myself a judge. The best I could hope for, if I'm put on trial, is to have a decent judge. The best. Or if I'm arguing as an advocate, to have a judge who's open-minded. And now suddenly I'm a judge, appointed by Mandela after a long process to sit on the Constitutional Court. This is what I was speaking about yesterday in the Constitutional Court, so I won't repeat what I said then. But one of the themes that was new in the systems of law that originated with the British common law, social and economic rights are included as fundamental rights. Ireland had had social and economic rights as directives of state policy. They're important, but they're not justiciable. You can't go to court to claim a right. It's up to the public power authorities to implement those policies, but the policies themselves cannot be used as a foundation going to court. India follows a similar pattern. Quite a long, strong list of binding policies that can be very useful for interpreting other laws, but can't be the foundation of going to court as such. Brilliant judges in the Indian Supreme Court say, of course they're non-justiciable, but to understand the right to life that is justiciable, life doesn't just mean brute existence. Life means a life with a right to health. Life means a right to have an occupation to make a living. So they effectively made the non-justiciable rights justiciable. We say in English, where there's a will, there's a way. Where the judges are attuned to the foundational needs of dignity of human beings. The text doesn't bind them, the text frees them. They can have an emancipatory vision that is not simply their subjective views, but a view that lies at the heart of the normative system of a contemporary constitution that upholds the fundamental rights in the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights, objectively codified in that way and now made justiciable in a court of law. The Indian judges found a way of doing it, but we didn't want that indirect form. So now we have in our constitution, everyone has the right of access to medical care. Everyone has the right of access to housing. Everyone has the right of access to education. Everyone has the right of access to water and food. Everyone has the right to welfare. And then each of these clauses is followed by a clause that says, the state shall take reasonable legislative and other measures progressively to realize the rights within its available resources. I'm not sure what the position is in Colombia. I know your courts have been very active. I suspect it's a different kind of a text. Where there's a will, there's a way. Where there's a will to frustrate those rights, the judges can restrict them to almost nothing. Where there's a feeling that apartheid has left our society with massive injustices, not just in civil rights, voting, speaking their minds, earning a living, but in terms of access to housing, health, education, and so on, then the courts have to find a way of responding and making these rights meaningful. And the very first case we had that compel the judges now to say how in a jurisdiction traditionally following a separation of powers conceptualization that says the judges don't make law, they enforce the law. Parliament makes the law, the executive leads the process of lawmaking and implementation. Now the judges are being called upon to actually enforce these fundamental rights, how to do it. And it's clean slate. We can't get any precedent from anywhere. The best is the Indian court indirectly through the back door introducing some form of enforceability in a particular case. And the case has become quite well known internationally. It's called the Grootboom case. Grootboom means big tree. And I remember the year because it was the year of Bush Jr., I call him Little Bush, Bush versus Gore in the United States, the year 2000. Mrs. Grootboom was living in, you would call it a comuna, in a low-lying area of Cape Town. The rains are coming. At that stage, it was flooding that was the enemy of the poor. Now we have drought. And she says, I can't bear it. Another winter, it's going to be wet. I have two young children. We live in a shack that's made of wood and corrugated iron and paper. And they go out and it's splash, splash, splash. So she and 1,000 others took their few belongings and pieces of material to a nearby hillside that was dry, only to find that hillside had been set aside for low-cost housing. They're expelled. They're evicted. They end up on a sports field. Not a beautiful sports field like you see in the soccer games, just a piece of dusty ground with some sticks at the end. That's where they're lying and sleeping. And a local attorney says, but our constitution says you have a right of access to adequate housing. How can you be sleeping out in the open with nothing? He goes to court. The matter eventually reaches the Constitutional Court. And I'm sitting up there and I'm imagining Mrs. Grootboom. It's nighttime. The clouds are overhead, maybe a bit of moonlight. She's lying next to her children and she's asking a question, why? Why? I've done nothing wrong. All I want is a shelter for me and my children. And here am I sleeping out in the open. And I can imagine there are 1 billion, 2 billion Mrs. Grootbooms in the world asking that same question. Why? And I'm now a judge, and my existential question is different. How? I don't know anything about housing. I know about human rights. I don't know about housing. How? And the state produces evidence to say we are progressively realizing this right within our available resources. At that stage, something like 1 million homes had been given free to people living in shacks with water, electricity, sewage. Not communities, not beautiful homes, but solid homes, which they could become the owner of afterwards. We are complying with our constitutional duties. And we had our discussion amongst the judges, and we're all pulling in two ways at the same time. On the one hand, the state is providing houses. The state has the evidence on priorities. She can't just vacate her homes that she's in and say, give me a house afterwards. There's a queue. There are criteria. The state is doing that. They know better than we do how to do these things. On the other hand, we're saying, If we can't find a remedy for Mrs. Grootboom now, 1,000 people sleeping, mostly women with their children, what does it mean to have these words in the Constitution? It's just an empty piece of paper. And we end up preparing a decision that became the foundation for our enforcement of fundamental social and economic rights. We took the phrase, the state shall take reasonable legislative and other measures progressively to realize the rights within available resources. For us, the key word was reasonable. Now, lawyers are used to the word reasonable. We use it in reasonable force to repel an attack. The reasonable driver doesn't go at such and such a speed or overtake a car. And reasonableness is always proportional and contextual. And we feel that is a discipline for us. And we're focusing on, I think you would call, structural remedies, not individual remedies. And we say what the state is doing by international standards is very praiseworthy. But the state policy, in one respect, is not reasonable. It has no program for crisis emergency housing situations, for victims of flood, of fire, of eviction. It must have some form of temporary accommodation for people who are waiting for permanent accommodation. That's reasonable. And that became the foundation of our jurisprudence. Now, many people, like I'm sure many in this room, from the human rights community, were angry with us. They wanted us to use a minimum floor foundation. You establish a minimum floor, and anybody below that minimum floor can go to court to say, we don't have our rights being respected. We left that open in the Grootboom case. But in the next major case we had on social and economic rights, the Treatment Action Campaign case, we were confronted with it and we dealt with it. Treatment Action Campaign was a body that was set up by people living with HIV. It had literally hundreds of thousands of members and supporters living with HIV. At a time when our president, it was well known, was denying that the virus existed, was saying that the people are victims of poverty, and he was following an American professor named Duisberg, who was saying it's the pharmaceutical companies have invented the virus that's never been isolated, never been seen, and that was his attitude. And in this case, women about to give birth, living with HIV, were demanding access to the antiretroviral called nevirapine. It was being provided free. It had passed the trials testing to be safe. It reduced the transmission from mother to child of HIV by about 50% then. Now it's about 95%. And the state was saying, we want to try it out in 2 state clinics in each of the 9 provinces for 2 years to see what problems might exist. And the woman was saying, we can't wait 2 years. We're having our babies tomorrow. And they got a lot of support through the press, through the media. The case comes to us. The advocate for the state says it's not for judges to decide on drugs. That's for the medical people in the government department. Judges don't prescribe drugs. That was his argument. And we disagreed. We disagreed. We said the Constitution grants rights in relation to progressive realization of adequate health care. And we as judges are guardians of the Constitution. We're under a duty. It's not a choice on our part. You're under a duty to enforce the Bill of Rights and the law. And even if it deals with policy matters, even if it has implications for budgets, that is our duty. And we're about to announce our decision in court. And my colleague, Sandile Ngcobo, who went on to become Chief Justice, said, "Albie, would you like a handkerchief?" And I say, "Sandile, it's not necessary. I'm prepared today. I'm okay." And the background to that was, a few weeks earlier, I'd been giving a lecture similar to this at the University of Harvard. And I mentioned a case where Sandile had written a judgment for our court in relation to a man who had applied for a job as a steward on South African Airways. And he passed all the tests with flying colors, but it turned out he was HIV positive. And South African Airways said, "We will employ you, but not as a steward. If our passengers get to hear that we are employing people who are HIV positive, they will go to British Airways that has a policy excluding such employment." And Sandile, writing for our court, said, "The right to work is fundamental to human dignity. And the fact that there are prejudices that are affecting the conduct of foreign airlines cannot be used to justify our airline behaving in a way that violates our constitution. We can't take our values from the prejudicial, discriminatory practices of other airlines." It's a beautiful judgment, beautifully phrased. And sitting in the court when we were delivering that judgment were rows and rows of people sitting like yourselves with t-shirts saying HIV positive. Black, white, brown, men, women, young, old, just like the nation, HIV positive. And I told the people at Harvard, he announced his decision, we file out of the court, there's dead silence. And suddenly cheering breaks out, which I can hear, and I start crying. And I'm crying not because of the impact of HIV in my country, which was so heavy and so hard. I'm crying because I'm a judge and I can do something as part of a team. I can use our constitution to advance the rights of people in ways that we hadn't even thought of when we wrote the constitution, because at that stage the impact of HIV hadn't been so great in our country. It was just overwhelming. So now we're going in for the Treatment Action Campaign case. We're going to deliver a decision saying that the mothers-to-be have a right of access to antiretrovirals. And we know the court will be filled with people wearing t-shirts, HIV positive, black, white, brown, men, women, young and old. And Sandile is offering me his handkerchief because somebody had written to him from Harvard saying, "You made your colleague Albie cry." And I say, "Sandile, it's okay. I'm ready. I'm prepared today." And we go into the court, and it is sitting filled with people like that. And our Chief Justice reads out elements of the judgment, and there's total silence. And we stream out at the back, and the cheering starts again. And I cry again. So I'm the judge who sang, and the judge who cried. Thank you.
Hola, hola. Hola, entonces invito ahora a Natalia y a José a que hagan sus comentarios. Yo te paso este. No hay problema, ya.
Bueno, yo tenía una presentación más formal, pero es que cada vez que uno oye a Albie Sachs queda absolutamente conmovido. Entonces yo quiero empezar también con una anécdota. Esta es la segunda vez que me invitan a hablar en honor del juez Sachs. y yo básicamente la vez pasada me invitaron porque todo el mundo sabe que mi inicio en materia de derechos socioeconómicos fue leyendo un escrito de ese juez surafricano que había escrito su título era Derechos socioeconómicos deben ser justiciables. Y en ese escrito empezaba diciendo, si a alguien hay que acreditarle quién es ese estúpido, decía así, estúpido juez que introdujo los derechos socioeconómicos en las constituciones, ese voy a ser yo. Y cuando yo vi que había alguien muy estúpido que había hecho algo que me parecía a mí tan importante como introducir los derechos socioeconómicos, que en realidad en países con tantas inequidades como los nuestros son vitales incluso para el goce de otros derechos, tuve que correr a saber quién era ese juez, y de hecho supe en ese entonces, yo era estudiante de Derecho, que estaba invitado a Cali a un evento cerrado. Yo hice lo que fuera para poder conocer a ese juez que en realidad había dado esa gran pelea. Y de hecho esa discusión se ata mucho con nosotros. Cuando nosotros sacamos la Constitución del 91, la discusión sobre si los derechos socioeconómicos debían estar en la Constitución o no, no fue tan fuerte como lo fue en Sudáfrica. En Sudáfrica, tengo entendido, había constitucionalistas norteamericanos que decían es una pésima idea incluir los derechos socioeconómicos como derechos justiciables en las constituciones, tener un catálogo de derechos socioeconómicos. Entre otras, el argumento era porque puede generar desilusión sobre los derechos. En la medida en que es tan difícil avanzar derechos como la educación, como la salud, como la vivienda, lo que usted va a generar es una desilusión sobre todos los derechos, incluyendo los derechos civiles y políticos. Creo que la defensa que hicieron en su momento en Sudáfrica fue muy importante en señalar que sin esos derechos y sin esos derechos en la Constitución, pues las constituciones en realidad iban a significar también poco para nuestras propias realidades. En realidad, las personas necesitan comer para ejercer sus libertades, y ambos tipos de derechos son importantes tenerlos. Ellos sí discutieron si deberían ser justiciables o no, nosotros no. Nosotros, de hecho, lo dimos por descontado, había que tener ese catálogo de derechos, porque era en realidad, en países con tan alta inequidad como los nuestros, algo que era esencial para las personas: educación, salud, etcétera. No discutimos si debería ese proyecto constitucional ser a través de los jueces. Lo iniciamos, y por eso me llama mucho la atención, pues con esas primeras sentencias, y una de ellas fue la del VIH. Nosotros tuvimos en el año 93 el primer caso, uno de los primeros casos en materia de derechos socioeconómicos fue del movimiento de VIH, que señaló que en la política pública de salud básicamente no estaban contemplados los retrovirales, y sin tanto esfuerzo y tanta emoción la Corte Constitucional concedió ese derecho. Pero en esos años 92, que uno hasta ahora estaba empezando a discutir si ese proyecto podría estar, lo cierto es que cogimos la misma línea en donde avanzamos los derechos socioeconómicos y empezamos a discutir sobre el potencial de estas nuevas constituciones que tanto en Sudáfrica como en Colombia se han dado en llamar constituciones transformadoras. Y la idea de esas constituciones transformadoras, que van a tener como base unas apuestas en derechos, entre otros en derechos socioeconómicos, pues tienen unos proyectos muy ambiciosos. Nuestro amigo de Esteban, el profesor Cutler, escribió un texto muy lindo que se llama Cultura Legal y el Constitucionalismo Transformador, y lo definía como un proyecto a largo plazo de promulgación, interpretación y ejecución constitucional comprometido en transformar las instituciones políticas y sociales de un país y las relaciones de poder en un ámbito participativo, igualitario y democrático. Como dice él, en el fondo el constitucionalismo transformador lo que busca es una idea de una comunidad altamente igualitaria, solidaria y multicultural. De todas maneras, tanto lo que sucede en Sudáfrica como en Colombia, la apuesta a un constitucionalismo transformador, pues va a estar llena de tensiones. La primera es que en la mayoría de estos países con estas constituciones transformadoras, o Mauricio García las llama aspiracionales, a mí me gusta más la palabra transformación, porque esto no se, los derechos socioeconómicos están contemplados como derechos que son capaces de reivindicar y exigir, no como meras aspiraciones. Pero en estos países con constituciones transformadoras, pues van a estar sumidos en lo que Boaventura llama, Boaventura Sousa Santos llama, la paradoja del Estado social. Y es que donde, en los países donde más garantía de derechos socioeconómicos se necesita, donde necesitamos estados que realmente impulsen los derechos socioeconómicos, pues van a ser los países que van a tener más problemas, entre otras, económicos para la realización de tales derechos. Obviamente, en esos mismos países hay una gran fe en el potencial del derecho por contribuir a esa apuesta constitucional, y en esas constituciones transformadoras, no solo en Sudáfrica o en Colombia, también en Brasil, el rol del juez se convirtió central como un actor que era capaz de potenciar ese constitucionalismo transformador. Llama la primera decisión, que no habló de derechos socioeconómicos, pero tenía que ver con derechos socioeconómicos, es la del famoso juez Ciro Angarita Barón, que tiene una frase que a mí toda la vida me ha parecido en materia de derechos socioeconómicos la mejor frase de todas las decisiones constitucionales. Y es que dice, la palabra social en la cláusula de Estado social de derecho no es una simple muletilla retórica que otorga un elegante toque de filantropía a la expresión Estado de derecho. Es en realidad una apuesta central, social. Pero como Angarita lo va anunciando, él dice, en esta apuesta el rol del juez va a ser central. Y voy a citar, dice Angarita en la sentencia T-406, existe una nueva estrategia para el logro de la efectividad de los derechos, la coherencia y la sabiduría de la interpretación, y sobre todo la eficacia de los derechos en la Constitución del 91 están asegurados por la Corte Constitucional. En el sistema anterior, la eficacia de los derechos fundamentales terminaba reduciéndose a su fuerza simbólica. Hoy, con la nueva Constitución, los derechos son lo que dicen los jueces a través de sus sentencias. Nosotros aquí hemos estado familiarizados, obviamente, con el activismo judicial que ha llevado la Corte Constitucional en materia de derechos socioeconómicos, y como en otros lugares de estas constituciones transformadoras, obviamente hemos tenido discusiones muy fuertes sobre el rol de la adjudicación en materia de DESC. Están obviamente las clásicas argumentos de si el rol del juez en la adjudicación de derechos socioeconómicos viola la separación de poderes o afecta el principio democrático. Obviamente ha habido una discusión muy, muy grande sobre el tema del impacto económico de las decisiones judiciales. Sin embargo, desde entonces nosotros no tenemos la pregunta de si los jueces deben intervenir en la economía, porque digamos nuestro sistema hace que lo hagan a través de la tutela, a través de la acción pública de inconstitucionalidad, sino como yo lo he dicho en varios lugares, la pregunta relevante se había convertido para nosotros en que ese constitucionalismo transformador a través de los jueces, la pregunta interesante debería ser en cómo los jueces deben adjudicar derechos socioeconómicos. Y en esa, la conversación se convirtió en una conversación muy interesante con la jurisprudencia de Sudáfrica. A diferencia de Sudáfrica, nosotros tenemos un litigio individual en materia de derechos socioeconómicos que es realmente abrumador. Solo en materia de salud en un año hay 150 mil tutelas individuales. Y yo creo que por lo menos en mi caso la preocupación de ese tipo de tutelas individuales se daba menos con las clásicas preguntas de la separación de poderes. Para mí la preocupación era un tema, y para mí y para otros colegas ha sido siempre una pregunta sobre la equidad. Yo sí creo en el potencial de los derechos socioeconómicos y siento también en el potencial que tienen a través de la adjudicación de derechos socioeconómicos. Pero me preocupa a través de las tutelas individuales que en realidad esa garantía termine dada solo para quienes puedan acudir a la justicia. Solo quien pone una tutela pueda verlo garantizado. Y es un tema de equidad, entre otras razones, porque los que más obstáculos de acceso a la justicia tienen son los más vulnerables. Por eso esa sentencia de Grootboom, que en realidad no solo llamó la atención en Sudáfrica, sino en todas partes del mundo, se convirtió realmente en una sentencia muy poderosa que terminó influyendo en el constitucionalismo colombiano. Porque esta sentencia lo que va a terminar es generando una decisión estructural que va a beneficiar más allá de quien pueda acceder a las cortes. Y de hecho también permite un reto mejor en términos de implementación, que es traer a quienes deben ser los interesados en la implementación a también pensar en cuál deben ser los remedios efectivos. Nosotros llevamos una larga discusión a partir de Grootboom con nuestras propias decisiones en las que entraron ahí la sentencia de desplazamiento forzado, la sentencia de salud, y digamos que los constitucionalistas llevamos un buen tiempo un poco entusiasmados con que el potencial de esta promesa de constitucionalismo transformador a través de las cortes se puede dar con este tipo de decisiones judiciales, dialógicas y de tipo estructural. Y ahí estaba nuestra conversación. Y estábamos un poco en este momento, en esta conversación, pero yo voy a... o lo que viene surgiendo en mi cabeza en los últimos meses es si en realidad estamos haciendo hoy en día la pregunta concreta o la pregunta correcta de si el constitucionalismo transformador se debe apostar o se debe impulsar básicamente a través de los jueces. Dado los cambios que está dándose hoy en la Corte Constitucional, en donde la Corte Constitucional está reversando sus propias decisiones, y si ustedes se están dando cuenta, las decisiones que está reversando la Corte Constitucional tienen que ver en materia de derechos económicos, sociales y culturales. Mi pregunta, por lo menos la que me está obsesionando y con la que yo no puedo dormir últimamente, no es cómo los jueces deben adjudicar derechos socioeconómicos, sino en realidad si la apuesta tiene que ser seguir apostándole al constitucionalismo transformador a través de las cortes. Y pues quienes me conocen saben que yo he querido esa corte con mi alma. Y no puedo dar una respuesta clara. Tushnet tiene un libro que se llama Sacar la Constitución de las Cortes. Y la pregunta es si en realidad deberíamos estar mirando a otro lado para avanzar este tipo de derechos. No he tenido una respuesta, y ayer cuando pensaba en el tema, la verdad creo que debemos seguir ensayando otras estrategias, pero anticipando que muchos de estos avances en materia de derechos socioeconómicos que se dieron a través de la Corte, pues en este momento pueden cambiar, y de hecho están cambiando, que una Corte Constitucional en los últimos años haya anulado 4 de sus sentencias, 3 de ellas en materia de derechos socioeconómicos, nos tiene que por lo menos hacer indagar si la apuesta de avanzar derechos socioeconómicos es por ese lado. Pero por el otro lado, me cuesta trabajo decir que no es ahí. Yo miraba ayer, los que estábamos en Bogotá nos salvamos de un gran trancón porque hubo estas marchas protestando por la educación gratuita y por no iba a la canasta familiar. Entonces me ponía a reflexionar y dice, bueno, mucha de esta marcha ha cambiado el marco en que se hace la protesta social, porque la gente está hablando ya en términos no de revolución, sino en términos de garantía de derechos. Entonces, esa apuesta de la Corte fue muy importante. De hecho, hay una gran sentencia que dice no iba a la canasta familiar en términos de derechos. Pero por el otro lado, entonces uno dice, bueno, ahora salgamos y reivindiquemos el constitucionalismo transformador en las calles. Pero al mismo tiempo que pensaba eso, abrí el periódico y el periódico decía: las marchas y la protesta social se nos salió de madre. Y es básicamente algo que ha pasado mucho en Colombia, y es que tendemos a estigmatizar la protesta social o las reivindicaciones sociales cuando se hacen en otros canales distintos. Por eso, de todas maneras, ese espacio de la Corte es tan importante en contextos como los nuestros, en donde la protesta social es tan estigmatizada, porque canalizan esas preocupaciones de la gente en términos de derechos y en términos sociales. Entonces, no sé cuál va a ser la respuesta, si hay que sacar la Constitución de las Cortes o no. Yo más bien abogaría por tener más jueces como el juez Sachs, no solo que nos canten, sino que en realidad tengan esta enorme preocupación por la justicia social y por hacerse esa pregunta de cómo avanzar.
Sí, hola. Buenos días. En primer lugar, pues muchas gracias al profesor Esteban Hoyos por la invitación, y al igual que lo plantea Natalia, pues digamos aquí tenemos una estructura más académica, pero que se queda o es completamente irrelevante frente al testimonio del juez Sachs, que pues en realidad es muy emocionante, muy inspirador, y muchas gracias. Pero bueno, finalmente me atengo a lo que tengo, pues tengo planteado acá, y básicamente voy a plantear cuatro comentarios en relación con lo que, digamos, algunos escritos que el juez Sachs había desarrollado hace algunos años, en especial en la relación entre el derecho internacional y los tribunales constitucionales. Digamos, allí pareciera especialmente enfatizar en una especie de relación de amor y odio entre ellos, pero digamos trataré de sacar algunos asuntos adelante. En ese sentido, entonces, en primer lugar, la pregunta es: ¿qué tiene que ver el derecho internacional con todo esto? Y yo creo que allí hay que plantear el asunto de qué entendemos por derecho internacional. Creo que hay dos, digamos, malos entendidos respecto a la manera como se aproxima el estudio y la concepción del derecho internacional. La primera es que, digamos, tenemos que entender el derecho internacional como un mecanismo, un medio de gobernanza de los asuntos internacionales y las relaciones, no solamente entre las estructuras tradicionales, que serían los estados, sino, digamos, todos aquellos que transitan entre los estados. Y en este caso en especial, cuando hablamos de derechos, los individuos y algún otro nivel de actores no estatales. Y en ese sentido se tiende a interpretar que el derecho internacional es un sujeto, pero en realidad no es un sujeto, es decir, no hay un órgano que podamos denominar derecho internacional, sino que vamos a hablar es de un ámbito normativo de gobernanza, que nos lleva a lo que podría yo encontrar como el segundo mal entendido respecto del derecho internacional, y es que lo planteamos en singular. Es decir, el derecho internacional pareciera identificarse como un cuerpo unificado, relativamente coherente, y lo que nos vamos a encontrar es que hay muchos derechos internacionales. No solamente podríamos hablarlo en el ámbito del derecho internacional de los derechos humanos, sino dentro de este mismo vamos a encontrar, digamos, una diversidad de ámbitos de operación, de aplicación, de gobierno, de unas normas en un sentido muy amplio de que denominaríamos derecho internacional. Y de hecho, podríamos decir, algunos plantean, digamos, hay un texto muy famoso este año, si el derecho internacional es realmente internacional, digamos, dejando atrás la discusión que está por allí en Hart de si el derecho internacional es derecho, sino que si el derecho internacional es realmente internacional. Y digamos sobre eso, quizá es donde vamos a encontrar una fase emancipatoria y contrahegemónica en la aplicación del derecho internacional, que nos puede llevar precisamente a la cuestión de la aplicación transnacional de los derechos sociales. Y de las garantías de los derechos sociales. Lo que me lleva al segundo punto, y es, hay un gran debate respecto del origen de esto que denominaríamos derecho internacional. Es decir, generalmente cuando hablamos de derecho internacional se plantea desde una perspectiva que podríamos llamar aséptica, objetiva, y en la cual, digamos, no hay claridad frente a los procesos. Sin embargo, vamos a identificar, y el gran debate, digamos, de los últimos, podría llamar, 30 años, es el derecho internacional es un mecanismo hegemónico, es un mecanismo imperial, o quizá de él podemos extraer algunas herramientas contrahegemónicas de emancipación, especialmente en el marco de los derechos. Allí, digamos, generalmente esto se engloba dentro de una corriente muy amplia que podríamos decir no tiene técnicamente una unidad temática, que son los denominados TUEI, las aproximaciones tercer mundo al derecho internacional, pero digamos, los primeros TUEI, que quizá podríamos hablar, esos abogados internacionalistas del mundo en desarrollo, del mundo de la descolonización en los años 60, quizá en los años 70, pues buscaban utilizar las herramientas existentes en ese momento. Posteriormente vamos a identificar una especie de desencanto, y ese desencanto se da frente a los límites de la acción internacional. Y creo que allí entonces es necesario precisamente enfatizar en una nueva aproximación, y es una nueva aproximación en la cual no solamente, digamos, podríamos decir, se de ese supuesto elemento dialógico entre una normatividad internacional, quizá luego hablaremos de unas instituciones internacionales, y el los ámbitos internos de operación. Y creo que allí es especialmente importante, digamos, los trabajos de los tribunales constitucionales. Pensemos lo siguiente: en el caso de Colombia, Colombia como Estado ratificó durante los 70 los pactos internacionales de derechos civiles y políticos y el pacto de derechos económicos, sociales y culturales. Sin embargo, digamos, hasta la entrada en vigencia de la Constitución del 91, en realidad no había un mayor uso interno de estos instrumentos. El cambio constitucional, la creación de un tribunal constitucional y paulatinamente entonces el uso de estos instrumentos, el desarrollo de un concepto que yo todavía denominaría muy ambiguo, como es el de bloque de constitucionalidad, permite entonces ese uso interno del derecho internacional, el cual entonces podríamos decir desarrolla una perspectiva contrahegemónica de emancipación y de materialización y garantía de derechos, y en este caso en particular de derechos sociales. Eso quizá va a dejar atrás, y yo creo que todavía allí, porque se plantea en la jurisprudencia constitucional, digamos, esa distinción que podríamos llamar entre monismo y dualismo. Es decir, creo que allí es algo que habría que dejar atrás, incluso en el ámbito del common law, donde hay una perspectiva consolidada frente a eso. En ese orden de ideas, entonces, ¿qué vamos a identificar? Vamos a identificar supuestamente un diálogo que podríamos llamar transnacional, en particular, como lo planteaba Natalia, entre el mundo en desarrollo, entre el, algunos lo denominarían el sur global, y cómo allí entonces habría, digamos, ciertas miradas contextuales más o menos comunes que permiten entonces un uso, digamos, más o menos común de esos instrumentos internacionales. De manera reciente, algunos han venido hablando de un derecho constitucional común, lo expresan bajo un denominador latino, por ejemplo, en el denominador castizo, el derecho constitucional común, digamos, donde habría unos patrones dialógicos más o menos uniformes debido a ciertas similitudes de contextos, de problemas sociales, de desigualdad, de pobreza y de desarrollo. Sin embargo, digamos, esto es un proyecto que podríamos decir no es coherente, es inacabado, está en constante desarrollo y evolución, y aquí al final plantearía yo una propuesta frente a este punto. Y de hecho, entonces, lo planteábamos en distintos casos que veríamos en el marco de Corte Constitucional y analizaba igualmente el juez Sachs, algunos hace un poco más de 10 años, como el caso ASAPO, digamos casos en el Tribunal Constitucional y el Sistema Judicial Sudafricano, como el caso ASAPO, digamos que digamos, ya empiezan a tener puntos de conexión con nuestro proceso siguiente en el marco de la Jurisdicción Especial para la Paz, como sería los debates respecto de la amnistía en el ámbito constitucional y el ámbito del derecho internacional, caso Bazón sobre crímenes de guerra, el caso Mohamed, digamos, en lucha contra el terrorismo y detenciones por fuera del marco del Estado de Derecho, asunto Kaunda sobre la protección y la extensión extraterritorial de los derechos garantizados en una constitución frente a sus nacionales ciudadanos, y allí no estaba, pues obviamente por cuestiones temporales, un asunto polémico de manera reciente, como es el caso al-Bashir, es decir, la solicitud de extradición de al-Bashir, el presidente sudanés, por parte de la Corte Penal Internacional. Y cómo allí entonces se da una separación en el marco sudafricano entre la posición del Ejecutivo, que hizo todo lo posible para evitar la extradición, y la acción entonces de los jueces en el marco del derecho penal internacional y las obligaciones de derecho internacional del Estado sudafricano, ordenando entonces su extradición. Entonces, obviamente, allí vamos a encontrar que quizá más que una relación de amor y odio, lo que hay es una gran cantidad de puntos comunes que nos llevaría al último punto, y es lo que llamaría yo, lo había anotado aquí en inglés, como un campo común en el cual se da el entrecruzamiento global y la aplicación contextualizada del derecho internacional por parte de los tribunales nacionales y de los tribunales que llamaríamos regionales de derechos humanos. Tanto en el campo africano como en el campo que llamaríamos interamericano, pero en realidad latinoamericano, pues vamos a encontrar que existe un sistema regional de derechos humanos. Si nosotros vamos a analizar el número de casos en el sistema interamericano, identificamos que, obviamente sabemos, obviamente no, hay dos niveles. El nivel, digamos que llamaríamos cuasi judicial o administrativo de comisión, y el nivel judicial de corte. El nivel judicial de corte, pues mediado por la acción de la comisión. Sin embargo, allí que vamos a identificar, cada vez más se encuentra en el ámbito de América Latina y en particular de Colombia, un uso recurrente a ese sistema interamericano con un mecanismo adicional de garantía de derechos ante distintos límites que se dan en el marco interno. Sin embargo, digamos, la fase siguiente, que sería la fase de Corte Constitucional, trata de diseñar un mecanismo que se ha denominado el control de convencionalidad, en el cual, digamos, se busca ese, precisamente ese uso directo e interno por el juez nacional de las normas internacionales, en este caso interamericanas, de protección de derechos. Creo que es algo que podría igualmente extrapolarse, como digo aquí, de manera contextualizada al ámbito sudafricano, pero al mismo tiempo hablarlo de o plantearlo desde una perspectiva intrasistema que deje atrás quizá esas fronteras digamos tradicionales de los derechos internacionales, y que precisamente genere una situación dialógica no solamente entre tribunales constitucionales, sino entre los distintos tribunales regionales de derechos humanos. Para terminar, si pareciera que, digamos, anotando el cierre de Natalia, que en nuestro contexto ese rol hoy en día no lo está asumiendo en los últimos meses el Tribunal Constitucional, sino el Tribunal Contencioso Administrativo. Es decir, digamos, en la competencia contencioso administrativo, ese tribunal de cierre ha hecho un uso más intenso precisamente de ese control de convencionalidad que el mismo Tribunal Constitucional. Creo que es por el momento suficiente, y agradeciéndole pues a todos.
Bueno, yo antes de darles la palabra a ustedes para sus preguntas, quería hacer un par. y creo que van dirigidas a Albi, como para poner acá a conversar a los miembros del panel. La primera, ¿cómo contestaría Albi Sachs a esta pregunta de sacar la Constitución de la Corte? Esa sería mi primera pregunta. Y la segunda también, como tus comentarios o impresiones frente a esta propuesta de diálogo, no sé si transnacional y transfronterizo, que José sugiere entre cortes de distintos niveles. Y en general, tus visiones sobre el rol del derecho internacional a nivel doméstico en Sudáfrica.
Well, thank you for giving me this chance. I'm used to, as the judge, having the last word. But in the academic setting, it depends not on me, it depends on you. And I believe the audience might be coming in as well. But thank you both for such rich responses and commentaries. I'm going to mention three things in response. The first, I'll call it the freedom and bread conundrum. What were we fighting for in our freedom struggle? Were we fighting for freedom or were we fighting for bread? And if you looked at the matter internationally and the international conventions, the International Civil and Political Convention is for freedom. If you look at the International Convention on Social, Economic, Cultural Rights, it's for bread. And our answer is, we were fighting for both. And it was important to say both. Those of us who are in the camp that spoke about so-called human rights often diminished the importance of the freedom rights. And we want a society that looks after the people, that ensures that people have housing and education and health. And that's the kind of democracy we want. It was called people's democracy. It was very powerful, very meaningful, particularly in poor countries where those aspects were undermined. But then the critics would say, you're allowing housing to trump rights, freedom of speech. So we said, we are fighting for freedom and we are fighting for bread. It's not for freedom without bread, bread without freedom, freedom and bread. And this was already while we were in exile, in the resistance, our vision. And I might mention, I went not too long ago to speak at the University of Massachusetts in Lowell, and they have a museum there. It was the first factory in North America. It was actually shipped as a factory from Manchester. And the people who worked there were women from the farms. The men stayed on the farms, the women came to work there. And they're very proud of the fact that the first strike by women workers was here in Lowell. And the slogan of the strike is, we are on strike for bread and roses. And so now I say our struggle was for freedom, for bread and for roses. And it is important. It's not just roses are pretty and roses smell nice. It's roses to deal with your humanity, your personality, your dreams, the interior side of human beings. And I belong to the critical legal scholars group that said we can't trust the judges with fundamental rights. They are fought out in the streets. They are fought out through the democratic institutions, and it's not the role of the judges to deal with that. Until I became a judge. And suddenly it all looked so different. It wasn't quite as simple as that. For us, the Bill of Rights became a strategic instrument in our, I'd say, revolutionary struggle to overthrow the system of apartheid. The whites were saying, we can't hand over power to majority rule. That will drive us into the sea. That will do to us what we did to them. So what we want is power sharing. And they used Aaron Leiphardt, who based a lot of his thinking on Colombia, in deeply divided societies. You don't give power to a majority. You share power between different political groups. In South Africa, it being different racial groups. And that would have had the effect of introducing a minority white veto in the power system. And that would have been intolerable and unacceptable. The whites owned by law 87% of the land, probably 95% of the productive economy. And power sharing would mean you can't change the status quo, you can't have transformation. So the answer of Oliver Tambo, who was Nelson Mandela's legal partner, now in exile, who set up a constitutional committee in exile, and who would meet in little places with the Zambian army around us to protect us from commando raids, and we're discussing a Bill of Rights for a future South Africa. And he said the answer to the fears of the whites, whether they're legitimate or not, they are real fears that we have to deal with, is not to have power sharing with three presidents, Mandela on Monday, de Klerk on Tuesday, Buthelezi from the Zulu-speaking people on Wednesday, having to get consensus, the Aaron Leiphardt kind of approach. That would be a disaster in South Africa. We need majority rule, one person, one vote, a non-racial, non-sexist system, and the protection will be given through a Bill of Rights. Protecting people not because they're white or black or majority or minority, because they're human beings. So for us, the Bill of Rights concept, paradoxically, was the foundation for getting majority rule. And it was also the foundation for a citizenship based on dignity. But a Bill of Rights means it's a Bill of Rights that prevents the parliament and the executive from undertaking measures that will now, it can be negative towards black people, or white people, or women, or workers, or Jews, or Catholics, or English speakers, or Zulu speakers. And who's going to decide that? The judges. Unless you have some independent body outside of the structures of power upholding these fundamental rights, then they are just a piece of paper. So now I'm becoming a convert. And of course, converts are more enthusiastic because they're not immune to the system. They're excited. They are reborn. And I'm in exile. And I can see a Bill of Rights now, in effect, is the foundation for democracy, for the people, for rights for everybody. It's strategic to our vision, new country. But that means the Bill of Rights must be entrenched. And it means the Bill of Rights is there for the groups that are vulnerable. That theme of vulnerability crops up again and again, marginalized groups that are not strongly represented in the power structures. The power structures were us, the ANC, Mandela. It wasn't the power of the oligarchs of the rich. But they are marginalized groups in our society. They need fundamental rights. They need to be protected. And it could be prisoners having the right to vote, which we insisted on. It could be people who've done terrible things, but they have the right not to be exterminated by the state. And popular, the populace would like capital punishment. We uphold fundamental rights. So the very notion of fundamental rights in that sense, it's not anti-democratic in a profound sense of democracy, but it is anti the idea of the political classes that gain a majority in parliament can do what they like. And then the issue becomes, who do you trust the most? The judges or the members of parliament to uphold the vision, the fundamental values? And my answer is, it can't be either the judges or parliament. There's no monopoly of protecting basic democracy, fundamental rights for marginalized people. Is an ongoing built-in tension between them. And what you need ideally is honest, empathetic, socially minded, idealistic judges, and you need honest and empathetic and socially minded members of parliament and presidents coming from that same background. That's the ideal. But as one African writer said, the beautiful people are not yet born. Constitutions are based on the fact that the beautiful people are not yet born. If the beautiful people are born, you don't need a constitution because beautiful people are beautiful. So we guard against that. But now in exile, as a convert to a Bill of Rights, our members are not comfortable with this. I'm speaking now to a group. I'm asked by Tambo to speak to a group of delegates from the ANC, from the militants, from the military, the diplomatic, the students and others. Fiery, passionate. Seizure of power. They love that word, seizure. Seizure of power, seizure of power. And I'm saying we need a Bill of Rights. What? Somebody called it a Bill of Whites. And I explained a Bill of Rights, it's diplomatically very good. It makes us look good. We are not bloodthirsty. Yes, that's right on. Bill of Rights, I say, is our answer to minority rights, which would protect a minority that behaved like a majority. That was the paradox in South Africa. The small group ruled over the majority and colonized and dominated the majority, and the majority were treated as though they were a minority to avoid that and to get majority rule right on. And I said, there's a third reason we need a Bill of Rights against ourselves. And I'm worried. Oh, it's okay for Comrade Albi, this bourgeois lawyer. The word bourgeois was very dismissive. Anything had to do with law, bourgeois law. Law is some other enemy of the people. And based on the lives the people led, it made sense. They hated the law. The law chased them. The law threw them into jail. The law protected the rich. The law was always against the poor, against women, against people of different sexual orientation. The law was the enemy. Now suddenly we have to see the law as emancipatory, as protective of people. But I said against ourselves. And I'm wondering, will they dismiss me? And instead I see, oh yes, 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 in their eyes. Why? Because we've lived in countries where people had fought heroically for freedom and gone on to become rulers, amassing a fortune for themselves, sending the opposition to jail. We've seen that. Countries that were helping us in our struggle. We'd seen in our own organization people had abused their positions. It could be to get sexual advantage. It could be taking money. It could be using a knife against colleagues. It could be driving when you're drunk. But it also could be political leaders behaving in an abusive way. We agreed then we needed a Bill of Rights then, as protection against ourselves as well. And that had to mean an entrenched Bill of Rights, and it had to mean judges who would uphold those rights. So now I started introducing into our debate, as a convert, the three generations of human rights. And I'd seen a paper by a Czech person working for the United Nations, and he wanted to justify environmental rights, and he couldn't fit it in. So he said there are generations of human rights, the classic civil political rights, the American Revolution, the French Revolution, the right to speak, separation of powers goes with it and so on. Then the social and economic rights, first in France in 1830 revolution, then strangely Prussia, the autocratic Bismarck, to get the workers on the side of the Prussian state. And then afterwards, social democracies or the Russian Revolution, putting them on the agenda, social democratic countries in Europe, especially Nordic countries. Now the third generation will be the green rights, the rights to environment, right to peace, right to development. And each cluster of rights has its own personality, its own meaning, its own mechanisms for enforcement. And I think the third, that question about public international law, is particularly important for the third generation of rights. If environment doesn't stop at boundaries, It doesn't. Peace doesn't stop at boundaries. Development doesn't stop at boundaries. And I think that's an area where the kind of dialogue that's been suggested could be particularly, not only could be, it's inevitably significant and important. Later on, I get criticized by the human rights community in South Africa. Who is that stupid person who spoke about three generations of rights as if the first generation is the important one, and the second comes second, and the third only comes third, so I put my head down then. But the fact is that we put that on the agenda. And in South Africa, in fact, the way it's turned out, when we were inaugurated as a court, Nelson Mandela was there, and he said, the last time I was in court was to find out if I was going to be sentenced to death. Today I inaugurate South Africa's constitutional court, on which the future of our democracy is very dependent. And it was prophetic, because not pathetic, prophetic. The court, in fact, in a sense, saved our democracy when it held against the president, who was overspending on his private home, so-called security. Parliament was protecting the president. The court really did pointed a very sharp finger at Parliament and at the president, upholding the democratic rights, upholding the rights of the people. When I was rushing for my plane afterwards, a few weeks afterwards, and we watched on television the Chief Justice announcing this decision and saying the president is not just the head of government with important functions and so on, the president must exemplify the values of our constitution. And the president failed to do that. And Parliament, protecting the president, failed. So that one branch of government is now giving a blow to both other branches of government. And I'm rushing to get my plane a little while afterwards, and a big, burly African man comes up to me, and he stops me, and he says, thank you, thank you, thank you. He doesn't even say why. And I said, it's not me, I've been off the court for 9 years. He says, thank you, thank you, thank you. He was expressing what the people in the streets were feeling, but they couldn't get it through going into the streets. Ultimately, the court was, in that sense, the savior. On the other hand, we look at the United States, the Supreme Court, almost struck down Obama health care, almost. The Supreme Court allows people to carry guns that can go up and shoot everybody. The Supreme Court strikes down a law that controls campaign finance that is so severely impacting on democracy. It's not the courts are heroes and Parliament is a villain. The courts are villains of Parliament. It depends very much on the context. The last thing I want to do is, now two other things, because it's my last opportunity, is to quote William Matunga, the former Chief Justice of Kenya, came up with a phrase that I thought is very, very beautiful. He wanted to speak about the importance of social and economic rights. He said, a Bill of Rights normally deals with the deficits of democracy, the failures of democracy, the gaps in democracy. You need a Bill of Rights. And he said, social and economic rights deal with the deficits of the market system. And it involves forms of intervention, fundamental rights that are important there. I think that's a very helpful point to make. The last point, though, is on public international law. There's an ongoing interaction between me, representing restorative justice, creative approach to law and international law, and Human Rights Watch. It was quite dramatic at a conference held by the Constitutional Court about 3 years ago. And Human Rights Watch saying international law demands no impunity. People who've been involved in any form of armed conflict that violates the Treaty of Rome, thou shalt be punished. And any peace treaty that goes against that is a violation of international law. Don't follow South Africa with the Truth Commission. and very dismissive of what we've done. And I feel surely international law is not just a set of rigid fundamentalist rules that's detached from the efforts of humanity to improve protection, dignity, and peace. There's something wrong if it's being applied in that way. And I think that the peace process that's been undertaken over a number of years by your leadership, with the involvement of the rebels and so on, is exceptional. It's extraordinary. It's thoughtful. It's not simply a process to end hostilities. Of course, ending the war is the fundamental thing. I'm already in a different Colombia than the last time I came. I don't think people quite realize how astonishing it is. It's not just you don't see so many armed people in the streets and all the rest. The expectations, the things you can do that you can imagine, it's different already. But the peace process means dealing with what caused the war, dealing with the issue of land, dealing with rights of indigenous people, dealing with the gender dimension to war. It means dealing with displacement. It means dealing with paramilitaries. It means dealing with the army. It's so comprehensive. This is enriching international law in a powerful way. It's not undermining, it's not a concession. It's not saying, oh, for the sake of peace, we have to undermine international law. It's adding layers and layers. And it's not an accident that you've had some of your most brilliant legal minds from the Constitutional Court involved in that process. And lawyers working, I've met some of them working with the FARC and the others, they're dealing with the specifics all the time. But it's out of these specifics that represent the major social tensions and fissures in society that other things emerge. And I just wish people like yourself could be writing this up, not in a defensive way, and not in a gloating way, because the problems are still severe, they're not resolved, but in a way that does justice to this huge contribution that's been made by Colombians to international, enriching it, enlarging it, and I'm happy to say it will find a lot of congruence in South Africa. You're not alone, as they say in the soccer field, chanting, we are not alone, we are not alone, you are not alone. And these themes now have become important in Northern Ireland in their peace process. They've become important in Sri Lanka, in different parts of the world. And I think it's very valuable and very important that the tributes be paid, not to give decorations, but to fulfill our task as legal people. I'm not sure everybody in the room are, you're all lawyers, but those of us who are lawyers, Martha Minow, whom I'm sure you're familiar with, in a book on disability, opens up the dean of Harvard Law School, saying, I dedicate this book to my father, who said the role of the law is to convert misfortune into injustice. And I think it's a very powerful phrase. I actually used it in a case dealing with domestic abuse. Domestic abuse is not something you put up with. It's got to be something the law must become involved to say this is injustice, it's not tolerated. And I see the same applying in terms of the misfortunes of law, of war, of displacement, of discrimination, of treating sections of the Colombian society as somehow lesser human beings. All of these things have to be dealt with and need to be dealt with, and to a certain extent are being dealt with. So viva the peace process in Colombia, but viva the lawyers who've been involved in enriching law and the vision of law and what law can achieve.
Bueno, vamos a hacer las preguntas. Veo a Julián. ¿Quién más tiene alguna pregunta? Y por allí vamos a recoger dos preguntas. Dame un segundo, Juli.
Sí, mi pregunta es muy breve porque sé que estamos cortos de tiempo y tiene que ver para preguntarle al juez Sachs sobre el concepto de reconciliación. ¿Cómo la Corte Constitucional en Sudáfrica trabajó el concepto de reconciliación sobre la base filosófica de Ubuntu, ¿no? De esa humanidad compartida, que es un concepto que se ha exportado a otros países del mundo, y que yo creo que es muy propio trabajarlo aquí en Colombia para lograr eso en este proceso de paz.
Maybe I can take a few questions.
Yeah, we're going to take a second.
La haré en inglés. No hay problema. Español. Bueno, igual muchas gracias por la conversación. Es muy inspirador ver historias en las cuales alguien que ha enfrentado intentos de asesinato por defender los derechos de los demás y ha logrado tanto. Aquí igual vivimos eso todos los días, aún gente que sigue siendo asesinada por defender derechos. Va la pregunta, para poder garantizar realmente los derechos a la libertad y socioeconómicos de las personas, el gran problema es de algún modo la distribución de la tierra, ¿no?, que ha causado las grandes inequidades con las que vivimos. Y en Sudáfrica en este momento se ha dado una discusión muy fuerte sobre la posibilidad de expropiación sin compensación, como una medida necesaria para precisamente, porque los blancos son dueños de más o menos 70-80% de las tierras, dijiste ahora que del 92% de las tierras productivas, y se hace fundamental pues aplicar estas medidas redistributivas. Por supuesto, un tema también muy importante para Colombia con las reformas agrarias y de tierras que necesitamos. Ha sido muy controvertido porque igual se atacan directamente los derechos a la propiedad privada. Hay una reacción muy grande, además mundial, geopolítica, de las derechas frente a este tipo de iniciativas progresistas, ¿no? Y bueno, quería saber más o menos cómo se ha planteado eso en Sudáfrica, cómo se ha manejado esa propuesta de la expropiación sin compensación, si eso sí es una buena idea y si es necesario para realmente conseguir garantizar estos derechos fundamentales de la sociedad surafricana, que hoy día sigue tan dividida y tiene tantos problemas de violencia aún.
¿Hay alguna pregunta adicional? ¿No? Listo.
Yo creo que podemos contestar.
Ah, ok. Perfecto. That's smart. On the top. Perfect. Yep.
Yeah. It's much better.
Okay. The land question is being very intensively debated in South Africa now. Our president calls it the original sin, the dispossession of the indigenous people. They lost their land, they never got the vote, their dignity, their languages, everything came from dispossession. Now people have the vote, they have dignity in multiple ways, but they still don't have the land. And so the land is important in itself as a source of security, of production, but it's important symbolically of historic dispossession. And Parliament is involved in it, the Constitution is involved, the court might become involved in it. I was involved last year that was the year of the centenary of Oliver Tambo, of his birth. And I gave a paper saying it's not necessary to alter our constitution to have extensive land reform, because our property clause already envisages the need for transformation. But the way the issue has evolved in South Africa, for all sorts of political reasons, the theme of expropriation without compensation has become extremely powerful. And people are saying, when the whites came and took our land, they didn't compensate us. And they give the example of, somebody stole my bicycle, now I want my bicycle back, why must I pay money to the thief? It's a powerful, symbolical, emotional, ideological push. And the government have agreed to expropriation without compensation. But, and of course, but can be as important as an affirmation, but we must not destroy production of food. People mustn't go hungry because of this. But the economy mustn't be disrupted so that you get the land, but nothing is functioning. And many people are saying you can have expropriation without compensation. It doesn't mean all expropriation is without compensation. In appropriate circumstances, the land is not being used. It's being held for speculative purposes by people who've got lots of land. Why pay them? When I was at school, the royal family from Britain came to South Africa, and Queen Elizabeth turned 21. So you can work out how old I am. Also Queen Elizabeth, 1947. And we were ordered to go to an airfield that had been, it was private land that had been given to the government for the sake of the war. Now that was already in before World War II. And it's been in government hands since then. And there's a desperate need for housing for poor people, not far away from work, close to their work. I would say not even one rand compensation for that. At the moment, under the law, because the idea was after the war they would get the property back. It's not being used for war purposes anymore. History now, and that family is very rich. They're doing very well. They've done well out of apartheid. I was actually told by somebody on the board for that family that we've already given it a value of one rand. So they've accepted the reality. There can be other pieces of land. The owners are hopelessly indebted. They can't function. The properties are deserted, they're empty, they're abandoned. No compensation required. It can vary quite a lot. That would be permitting expropriation without compensation, not requiring it, and then leaving it as a question of policy in different circumstances. One of the important distinctions being made now is land in rural areas and land in urban areas. The pressure for land is greatest in urban areas. It's for housing close to work. It's very imperious. Suddenly big businesses are discovering they've got lots of land they're not using. They're holding it for future benefit at some stage. The state owns lots of land that's not being used in many ways. These areas of land now must give way to the needs of the people without cost in acquiring the land. That's one argument. The other argument is, no, we must allow the one party in Parliament, economic freedom fighters, they call themselves, they want to nationalize all the land without compensation. And then you lease it out to people. And they say that's done in Mozambique and it could be done elsewhere. But many people are worried about that. When the state can confiscate land, the land doesn't end up being used by the poor. It's given to relatives of the benefit goes to relatives of people in the state. Anyway, what is important now is there's a huge national debate. Parliament went out all over the country. It's received more than 500,000 comments from the public. Most of the written comments are against expropriation without compensation. Most of the people in the rural areas say expropriation with compensation. Parliament has to deal with that issue. And what is interesting for me is it's not the outcome that's going to be so important, it's the process followed. The process of reconciling what seems to be irreconcilable issues. And the President has established a team that includes people from the agricultural production area, from the Afrikaans-speaking community, landowners representing them, the more forward-looking ones. It includes people who've been activists on the question of land, demanding land reform. It includes academics. It also includes a young friend and colleague of mine now, who was a law clerk at the Constitutional Court, Tembeka, who's a historian, who's written about this issue. It's a very broadly based group. And the idea is to get a consensus that can work with a view towards improving the rights of the people in a dramatic way, and if necessary, altering the constitution to that effect. In terms of the Truth Commission, our constitution was amended, the constitutional draft, just before it was adopted in Parliament. with a post-amble, I call it, a prologue at the end, an epilogue, not written in formal legal text as a clause. And the epilogue said that we must deal with the untold injustices of the past in a meaningful way, but not in a spirit of vengeance and retaliation, but in a spirit of reconciliation and Ubuntu. And Ubuntu is an African word that's used a lot in South Africa now, that says, I am a person because you're a person. My humanity and dignity depends upon acknowledging your humanity and dignity. It's the opposite of the extreme American position, I'm free to do what I damn well like, and there's some limits, as long as it's not affecting the freedom of others. But we're all seen in that as atoms colliding. The Ubuntu position is conceptually very different, that human beings are interdependent, that my autonomy, the richness of my personality, is enhanced by acknowledging my relationship with other human beings. It fits in very well with a dignitarian approach that takes from communitarian and takes from libertarian, both of them. And that has become very foundational to our jurisprudence in a number of different areas. When it came to abolishing capital punishment, the idea that human beings can extinguish one of their own cold-bloodedly and deliberately was seen as a violation of human interdependence. In the case of an eviction matter where black families had moved onto vacant land owned by neighboring whites who were very well off, and they'd lived there for some years, the whites went to the local council, which the black council said, get an eviction order. The eviction order was granted. It was taken on appeal. It was overturned on very unsubstantial technical grounds. It came to our court, and I was asked to write the judgment of the court. I had a crisis, a real crisis. I said, I've sworn to uphold the law without fear or favor. You can't come under our system that recognizes property and put your house up on somebody else's land. And I'm a judge and I must uphold the law. But I, as Albie, I can't do it. The whites have got their homes because the law favored them over the years. Black people are wanderers in their own land. They've got nowhere to go. They put, I can't do it. I've been fighting against this injustice my whole life. So if Albie the person is fighting against Albie the judge, then I can't distort the law to favor Albie the person. But I can't myself sign that order. What's the answer? Not saying a clever lawyer. A lawyer living in a constitutional state turns a personal dilemma into a constitutional tension. And the tension is between the rights of property, which we say nobody shall be arbitrarily deprived of their property. We don't have a right to property, to hold property. We have a right not to arbitrarily deprive the property, on the one hand, and the right to a home on the other hand. There's a collision. And I quoted the German Constitutional Court's second chamber in an abortion case, saying some cases have no right answer. Don't look for a right answer that covers everything. It has a best answer. And the best answer in this case was to say, the law said, eviction orders have to be just and equitable, taking account of all circumstances. And what was just and equitable to the poor was very unjust and really inequitable to the landowners. The answer was, I said, mediation. And if the landowners can find alternative land, they've got the money, that's one way of maybe doing it. Meaningful engagement has to be, a procedural aspect has to be introduced to deal with that tension. My colleague Zach Yacoub said, Albie, mediation is too weak. Meaningful engagement, that's the important one. He lifted it up. So together with the reasonableness principle, meaningful engagement now has become central to our whole social economic rights jurisprudence. And it's being used not only in evictions, but education, health, elsewhere. And that's part of the answer to Natasha's challenge. The judges are saying, we don't know the answers. And we can't just leave it to the political system. The parties involved, that's the people, the local authorities, the other landowners, must meaningfully engage with a view to saying, okay, you get off the land, but alternative accommodation has to be provided in circumstances that are compatible with the values of our constitution. And that's become a very, very rich tool in terms of enforcing social and economic rights. It's not a right that's established purely through interpretation. It's a right that's established through interpretation and values, but also through the parties themselves getting together and coming up with a solution, coming back to the court. And I mention this in answer because in writing that, until then I've been saying, Ubuntu is a fantastic value, it's extremely important, but it just informs, it's not a source. It's not an operational legal principle in itself. And I said, it's an operational legal principle. Our whole Bill of Rights is operationalized through the spirit of Ubuntu. And now the whole human rights community regard me as a kind of a hero, because now Ubuntu lives. Ubuntu is powerful and strong, not simply as a nice value and a good thing to have, but it can actually be used in litigation. And I said, the assault in the case of the homeless putting up their shacks on the land belonging to others, it's not just against the poor. It assaults the dignity of all of us in South Africa. All of us, that we're living in a country that has resources where we have homeless people like that. And that's the spirit of Ubuntu. And Ubuntu then becomes both a principle of procedural way of getting substantive law. It was Arthur Chaskelson, the head of the court, who said to me, Albie, you know, the role of the court is a different one. It's not just declaring rights. It's to manage very stressful procedures in principled ways. But then the role of the court becomes particularly important in that respect as well. But Ubuntu then becomes part of the philosophical vision. The debate between the communitarians and the libertarians is resolved. No debate is ever resolved forever and ever. But the best of the communitarian is absorbed into it, because we live in our bodies, our communities, our societies, our languages, our cultural groups. There's no individual lives outside of that, unless you're sitting on a pole in the desert. But even then, somebody's feeding you while you're communing with the eternal. And at the same time, we are not subject to the commands and the demands of the collective. Each one of us has a conscience. We have a right to make choices. We have a right to freedom in that sense. But the two, that right is interdependent with the rights of others and respect for others. It's not in competition with others. And that's foundational to all our thinking as judges now in a whole range of areas, and even in developing private law, that kind of thinking comes into it.
Thank you so much, Albie, for joining us today, for sharing your testimony, for your deep answers to all the questions and comments. Thank you, Vanessa, because this could have happened without you wanting to come to Medellín. And thank you, muchas gracias a todos ustedes por habernos acompañado. Hoy a Cristian y a María José por todo su apoyo, a Ángela y a Cecilia, que siempre nos ayudan con todo, y creo que les tenemos ahí como una sorpresa afuera para ustedes. Muchas gracias a todos.